Excellent.
What's up, guys? Welcome back to Paul's Hardware. It is mid-August, so that means it's time for another episode of Probing Paul, the monthly series that I do where I answer questions that you guys have asked. Last month's was number 17, so this is episode number 18. So most of the questions from today do come from last month's video, although I did reach out on Twitter and I grabbed a few questions from there as well. If you want to follow me on Twitter, it's at Paul Hardware, Paul with no S. Paul Hardware, and let's get started with today's first question, which comes from Alexander Galloway, and he's asking specifically about delidding a 7700K. Delid or to not delid, and if you do delid, should you use liquid metal or carbon-based thermal compound between the die and the heat spreader? A good question, Alexander. I get asked about delidding a lot. It's not something I've really covered on my channel, but it is something that I might potentially cover in the future. If you're going to be delidding something like 7700K, I treat it as something that's a little bit more out there when it comes to PC building. It's a little bit more niche, and it's something that I equate it kind of like when I did a full custom sleeving on a power supply. It's just something that not everyone does, but when you get into it, it's fairly interesting, although it can be a little time-consuming and a little bit dangerous. More time-consuming for the power supply than and more dangerous on the CPU side, but definitely recommend using a tool that's specifically made for it, like the DLID tool that DeBrower makes, and I'll put a link to his website in the video description. I have this one, which is specifically made for 7700Ks, and everyone who I've talked to said that this makes it like easy and a no-brainer. It's obviously never going to be completely safe because you are separating two parts from a component that Intel has not made to be separated by the end user, but the DLID tool can help you do that a little bit more safely. And if you're going to go that far as to DLID, then sure, use some liquid metal stuff. I've read varying reports on liquid metal efficacy when it comes to something like this, but a big part of the reason that you DLID something like a 7700K is to get rid of the crappy TIM that Intel already uses. So if you're going that far, you might as well spend a few more bucks, get some liquid metal stuff. Just remember that it is conductive, so make sure you're only applying it to the die itself and you're not using too much so that it might spread out and cause some shorts somewhere. That's about all I have to say about that right now. I do have this tool, so hopefully sometime in the future I might be able to actually put it to good use and maybe do a video on that. Next question is from Tech Showdown. He asks, which reviews do you enjoy doing the most? Laptops, motherboards, CPU, GPUs, cases, etc. It's a good question and something that like probably would change over time for me. In the past, I would say, you know, the CPU and GPU new launch videos were the ones that I was most excited about. I probably would still say that, although having just come off the Threadripper and Vega launches back to back, when they're so close together like that, it can be a little bit overwhelming. So that makes it more of a challenge. I'd say the stuff I like to do most right now is the stuff that I find to be a little bit more unique and a little different. I would point recently to my Can You Passively Cool Ryzen video, which was just an idea I had where I was like, all right, Ryzen CPUs, TDPs are pretty reasonable in the 65 watt to 95 watt range. There is passive coolers that exist that can dissipate that much heat. How's it going to work? And I'm also going to be using that from HTPC. So that's one of my favorite videos that I did recently, just because I felt like it was a little bit different. Involved some testing and that kind of thing, but wasn't the standard, like, here's a new GPU, run it through all the tests and spit out the results and everything. But yeah, I like new stuff that I get to take a look at before it's actually launched, but I also like finding just unique use cases and video ideas that are a little bit different than what you might typically expect. Next question from Senior Junior. Should I buy a Windows 10 license from Kingwin, or should I just buy from Microsoft? Don't want to pay $100 for the license, also don't want to get a virus or have the key suddenly not work one day. Well, the good news is that you can just go to the Windows website and download the Windows 10 installer and put it on a USB and install it onto a system, and it'll just work. And you'll get the little watermark in the bottom corner that says it's not a valid license or anything like that. And you can use that functionally for a while. You can't personalize it or anything like that. So I do like having the full legit copy. I will provide just an update to the Windows 10 for $20 video that I did over a year ago now, which is one of my more popular videos with 1.7 million views. But you can go to Kingwin, and it's more like $30 now, and you can get a key, and it's delivered to you. My advice for you guys is, one, yes, it still works, and I have used it probably 3-4 times in the past 3 or 4 months. And the keys, as long as you're getting Windows 10 keys, have worked for me. I activate them immediately every time. I only buy a key when I know I'm about to use it, so I can make sure it works. And on the few times when it hasn't worked, you have to use the Windows call-in function, which I'm somewhat familiar with. But calling in to activate, as long as you tell them it's only ever been used on one computer, which should be true, then you should be good to go. And I would say, yeah, if you want the full Windows copy, King Wind still seems like a viable way to go and get that. My next question comes from Twitter. This is from Colby, or Lazy Beard. Larger air coolers, is it worth it going with LPX memory? He's looking at a Dark Rock Pro 3. I would say yes. That is the biggest conflict, typically, when it comes to larger air coolers, is going to be the width of your case, if it's a really tall one, making sure it will fit there, and then, of course, clearance with memory. If you're already going with low profile memory, which is totally fine, if you don't care about your memory being visible, like you get an RGB stuff, because that would be kind of a shame to get the RGB, like G-Skill or Corsair memory, and then like put a big air cooler over it. So if you're not worried about seeing your memory, then yeah, totally fine. And I actually really have a fondness for large air coolers. Even though water coolers are very effective at dissipating heat and can lead to the lowest temperatures and usually the best overclocks, a big old air cooler simply has fewer points of failure. There's no pump that can go out. If an air cooler does fail, the fans are going to fail, and it's still going to function enough to keep your CPU cool enough, whereas if the pump fails on a water cooler, your CPU will overheat and force a shutdown of your computer, which can lead to issues and has caused me some trouble in the past as well. So if you're going for a good cooler that's also simple, that you will do its job, stay quiet, and you don't have to worry about leaks or pump failure, then yes, a big air cooler is the way to go, and that is specifically the reason why in the capture system that I built right over here, I have a big old Noctua NHD15 cooler rather than something a little bit more complex like a liquid cooler, even though a liquid cooler might keep things a little bit cool in there since I do have a 6950X. But even the 6950X is doing fine. Next question here from George Shaw, and this is, Paul, do you hate miners? And I'm going to segue this question into a few other comments on different things going on right now. So first off, let me just state for the record and everything, I do not hate miners. I do my very best to not hate anything if it's not necessary to hate that thing. And when it comes to miners, this dives into like a little bit of like economics and perspective on that and everything, but I believe that when someone has an incentive to do something and it's going to make them money and it's not necessarily outright hurting anyone, I can't blame people who are mining Bitcoin or Ethereum or whatever else they might be mining if they're able to make a profit from it. Because once you show that, like, here you can make a profit doing this, people are going to do it, and I don't blame them for that. Of course, this has led to complete selling out of most of the mid-range cards in the GPU market, and that is a shame for gamers. It sucks to want to build a gaming PC, have $250 or $350 bucks to spend on a graphics card, and just have nothing available there that's a reasonable price that's not grossly overpriced. So that really sucks. I try to look at it from both sides, and while not condemning miners for what they're trying to do, trying to make a buck, also view it from the gamer's perspective, where you're just trying to build a system to game on and get things done that way. There's obviously other stuff that you could talk about when it comes to like energy usage. Are you using an energy source that is based on fossil fuels, that's using more power to burn more fossil fuels and potentially hurt the planet when it comes to global warming and that kind of thing? Obviously, there's a ton more discussion that could be gotten into right there. But no, I don't hate miners outright. I understand what they're doing and why they're doing it, and I don't blame anyone for trying to make a buck. However, there's no denying that this is causing a pretty difficult situation for PC gamers out there, and even a very interesting situation when it comes to Vega, which is out now, but very hard to find. Sold out immediately, and there's just a really strange, difficult to completely assess problem right now going on when it comes to Vega pricing. They'll sold out immediately, but now it seems to be up in the air as to whether AMD is going to even be selling these at the prices that they originally told reviewers that they were going to be. That being $399 for the basic level Vegas 56 and $499 for the basic level Vegas 64, which seem to be, especially for the Vega 56, very reasonable prices. We have not received a straight answer from AMD as to if the prices are going up, if the rebates that they gave to retailers to sell their initial stock at lower prices is just going to dry up and then the prices are going to go back up, or if it doesn't even matter at all, and even if they tried to sell at low prices, it wouldn't matter because all the inventory would be gone, and then either retailers or third-party sellers would buy the stock and then relist it for $200 or $300 or $400 more than it actually costs. In my opinion, this has put AMD in a very challenging situation where they have a graphics card that's not performing quite up to what they were expecting. Came in a bit late too because of HBM2 yields, we assume. However, AMD is also in a situation where they can sell these for their original price, even though they're not performing competitively against the Nvidia competition when it comes to gaming, and they could recoup some of their money. Now, that sucks again for gamers who wanted to just buy these cards for the prices they were listed for. It sucks for reviewers who maybe were told one price they were going to sell for and did reviews based on that price. And it also sucks for anyone who's just looking for a reasonable graphics card to use with a FreeSync monitor, because if you can't buy the card, then you can't use it to play games with a FreeSync monitor. I know this has been a little bit all over the place when it comes to the discussion of this, but I feel like there's lots of nuances to this discussion, and there's lots of different sides you can look at it from, and whenever when I'm addressing something like this, that's one thing I try to do, is take a step back and look at it from the different perspectives of different people who might be involved in the situation. That's pretty much all I have to say for it for now. We're still waiting on some real, concrete, official response from AMD as far as what their official MSRP is going to be for the Vega 56 and the Vega 64, and once they tell us that, we will respond in kind, either with videos or on the live show or that kind of thing. Next question, though, is from Matt Johnson. This is another one from Twitter. What's your favorite video game? This one's a little bit simpler than the last question to answer, although I'm going to answer it in a complicated way. I have several favorite video games because video games have to look at history. All right, long time history, Final Fantasy series was always a favorite of mine, although I haven't played a new Final Fantasy game in quite some time. World of Warcraft always has a special place in my heart. Of course, played a ton of that. And I kind of miss the massive game that lots of people played that you can go into. Like, I feel like the community aspect of World of Warcraft is one thing that I seriously, seriously miss. And that's why I kind of wish there was another game kind of like it that took off and got really huge like that and had the same sort of community aspect to it. My favorite games more recently, I've really enjoyed Overwatch. I think that's an incredibly well-balanced game that's fun to just jump in and play for a lot of different experience levels. And then Civilization, I also have a long-time love affair with, going back to some of the earlier versions. So I've played a decent amount of Civ 6, and actually, if you look at the past year, that's probably the game that time-wise I've invested the most time in. But that's because you play Civ 6 and you start a game, and then 80 hours later, you're like, what happened? What happened to me this week is awful. But yeah, those are a few of my favorite games, at least. Another question here from Twitter, although I'm kind of blocking it. Sorry about that. Hey, Paul, just wondering what the first piece of tech you remember getting super excited about as a kid was. A Wang PC for Christmas was mine. That's pretty awesome. All right, so first piece of tech I remember getting excited about as a kid. I would say Commodore 64. Gosh, I'm old. My dad got a Commodore 64 for us really, really long time ago. I remember loading up Jumpman Jr. off of cassette tapes. That was really old. Probably standing out the most to me is like me being a kid and getting super excited would be original Nintendo launch. Yes, I was young enough to have gotten an original Nintendo. I think I was like 12 at the time, something like that. So there we go. Beyond that, a Super Nintendo as well. I saved up and got a used one, and I had to go on a really long waiting list for that. And then finally, when I was like 14, we bought our first computer. My dad took us out to go and do that. My first like full desktop type computer, and I remember being pretty stoked on that. And that's when I first I swapped out the RAM. That was the first PC upgrade that I did. And from there, I really liked working with computers. Next question, also from Twitter, from Romeo B, or Roma Yoger. How did you and your wife meet? A good question. It was the storied past of romantical, very rose-colored tinted. We both worked at Newegg together, actually. We were kind of in the same department, although we worked in different locations, and I met her through there. There was a lunch meeting where our department brought the different locations where people were all together, and we sat next to each other at lunch. And I told her that I make ribs that are really damn good. And she was like, I like ribs. And then like a week later, I made them for her. So that was like the trick to it. I made a statement and then I followed through on it. That's really important. You got to show women that, you know, you're a man of your word. Also, she like within a week or two after that was like, hey, I just started playing this game called World of Warcraft. Do you want to play it with me? Anytime you meet a girl and she invites you to play a video game with her, keep her forever. Final question for today requires a bit of a not safe for work warning, so you have been warned, slightly not safe for work, sorry about that, but this was like the most popular question asked last month. So here it is. Hey Paul Titzerats. There we go. A good question, a question that we all must ask ourselves, at least if you're a dude or if you swing both ways, I guess. You know, that's a tough call, and I am of two minds, as we might always be when faced with two tantalizing options. But you know, you got to make a choice one way or the other, and although it is difficult, got to go with tits. And guys, on that final note, which I hope does not get this video flagged for inappropriate content, I am going to finish off this episode of Probing Paul. Of course, if you guys have questions for me to answer next month, leave them in the comment section below and hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed this video on your way out. I certainly enjoy answering your questions. I know there's way too many for me to answer every month, but I do get to as many of them as I can, and I try to pick ones that are at least somewhat interesting for you guys to hear the answers to. Thanks again for watching this video, guys, and we'll see you next time.